of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, my rock and my salvation. Amen. Many of us by this time may be feeling anxious. And that's a logical feeling to feel, anxious. We have talked about the darkness that resides in our lives, the darkness that plagues us in the night, the darkness that resides in our own minds. Oftentimes, we as Christian folk gloss over the hard times for folks. We say things such as, chin up, God is with you. We say, great is the Lord and worthy to be praised. Cast your cares upon him. Have you been in a place that is dark and heard these? You will know that these platitudes aren't always the best. They're given by people that are well-meaning, people that are good and have good intentions, but they may not be enough. Suicide is a dark subject. In fact, we find that one of Jesus' own followers committed suicide, Judas. It's something that in the church we say he got what he deserved as he climbed up that tree and jumped. It's a darkness. It is a blight on the Christian story. It's one that I am uncomfortable with. Suicide touches us all. I have a great uncle named Wilfred. Wilfred was one of those guys who fought in World War II. He was known to be shell-shocked. Unfortunately, Wilfred took his life by drinking carbolic acid. He suffered a lingering death. In my own lifetime, I have experienced the deep sadness of how suicide has touched me. On my 8th birthday, I had the privilege of going with my Uncle Paul to a Rangers game. I was so excited, and we went and we saw them beat the Baltimore Orioles. I still remember that. We had someone from Baltimore with us in our group from the church, and they were cheering on those Orioles. I wondered what was wrong with that guy. Within about a month or 6 weeks, Uncle Paul had committed suicide. At the age of 27 or 28, a young man who was going through some difficulties went into his garage and hooked up the garden hose to his exhaust and left it running. This past month, we read The Life of Ovi. It's a story that details a Swedish man and how his depression has gripped him since the passing of his dear, beloved wife. In the movie, it has some dark humor to it, where Ove tries to commit suicide in several different ways, but is unsuccessful. It's a sad commentary on our life that Ove was one of those who was off by himself, that he was made redundant, as the English say, that he was let go of his job and retired at 65, that he was made to go home and he had no friends. Through the story of Ove, we see of local folks reaching out to him, unlikely friends, an Iranian woman who had come to Sweden with her children and shared good Persian food and reached out. Ove teaches her how to drive a car, but not any car, a Saab. The Saab was the best car for Ove, and it's what colored his life, and it reminded him of his dad, who ironically was hit by a train. Ove had life was much like a country song set to a tune in Sweden. Many of us have aches and heartaches. We remember folks who are no longer with us. Chris Cornell of Soundgarden just this past week committed suicide. I was reading an article this morning about what a devoted father he was and that he had an addiction to painkillers. They think he took too many Ativans and was somehow in an altered state when his depression creeped up on him and took his life. I'd like to do something here, and if you're uncomfortable, that is okay, but I want to have a naming ritual. I want us to be able to name those in our lives who have passed from suicide. So if you feel comfortable sharing those you have lost, this is the time to share. I will start. Paul.
Mary Ann.
Jerry.
My sister, Lori Long.
Kathy Carlson.
Jenny.
Eric. Joe.
We sit here with uneasiness. I see your hearts opening old scars and tears just behind your eyes as you share the names of those you have lost, those that I've lost. At this time, we call on the Prince of Peace to come into our lives. Many of us harbor sadness for those we have lost, but we also harbor anger, and we harbor resentment for leaving us, for having us on the edges of their lives, for keeping us at a distance. Many of us live with survivor's guilt. I often say God calls us to do more and be more. We're not called, all of us, to be therapists. We're not all called to be counselors, but we are all called to give mercy, to love with abandon, to say that we notice you have been down recently, that you look like things aren't going all right, that you seem a little run down, or you seem like you're really happy, and I just want to hear about that. What's going on? We come together as a community in this church to share our sadness and our joy. We share about what happens in our lives, and we say it is time to stop the stigma. That we live, each of us, with demons in our lives, and oftentimes we call them demons, but the reality of it is we all are touched in some way by folks living with mental illness. Ourselves, our loved ones, the ones that we meet on the street, we are called to love and to support. This week, I hope that you don't take and stop loving, that you reach out like a tree reaches into the spring sunshine, reaching its limbs out and growing. If you know of someone who suffers from chronic depression, who lives with chronic anxiety, it's okay to say, hey, I'm here for you. There are groups that come together that deal with these issues. Groups that you can talk with if you've lost someone, such as loss. Groups you can come together and talk about your frustration about isolation. If you feel like you are all alone, my door is open. If you feel alone, I would ask you to open your hearts and your minds to the love of those who are here. We have a telephone directory of our church. Feel free to pick up that directory and reach out. That's what it's there for. We are a community of God, and we are called to embrace each other no matter where we are on life's journey. Whether everything is hunky-dory and great, or whether everything is rotten, we're here. Let us be a people who reach out in love and in peace and in mercy, today and all our days. Amen.